The next item on the order paper is a motion on the manufacturing strategy for Northern Ireland. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the marshal list. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. Clerk, please read the motion.
That this Assembly calls on the Minister for the Economy to commission a manufacturing strategy for Northern Ireland.
I call on Mr Stevie Aiken to move the motion, as this is Mr Aiken's first opportunity to speak as a private member. I would remind the House that it is the convention that a maiden speech is made without interruption. However, if it becomes overly controversial, he may not be granted that privilege. Thank you, Mr.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And just for the record, and because my mother won't be upset about it, it's Mr. Stephen Aiken. I don't think I've been called Stevie for a very long time, but thank you, Mr. Speaker. In moving the motion for this Assembly for a call on the Minister of Economy to commission a manufacturing strategy for Northern Ireland, first thing I would like to say, this is a historic occasion, because we believe this is the first official opposition debate in this chamber since, I think, 1972. But overall, we welcome the Minister's appointment, and we, as the opposition, will offer constructive and supportive scrutiny to help build an effective strategy for our manufacturing sector. And what we want to see is how we can grow it from its present level over the next 10 years. As you're well aware, manufacturing generates annual sales approaching $20 billion. Directly employing 85,000 people, supports production and employment over 214,000 in the wider supply chain, and creates well-paid jobs and strong communities in every constituency across Northern Ireland. And we will indeed provide constructive support for the Minister, providing that policies are put in place to create a shift from a public sector-led to a strong, stable and flexible private sector economy that has Northern Ireland manufacturing at its core. It is also good to see a Department of Economy has now been created, a long-standing objective of our party, a department that should be the driving force for Northern Ireland going forward. And the need has never been greater, with our economy growing at less than impressive GVA, gross value added level, over the years 210 to 214 of 10.2%, with the UK average being 16%. Indeed, Northern Ireland has the lowest GVA growth of any UK region and is considerably less than the Republic of Ireland. And if we look further back to 2009, that while the UK's GDP as a whole has increased by 13.9%, that of Northern Ireland has only grown by 3.1%, which I'm sure the Minister would agree is a very poor outcome. So what are we going to do about it? We cannot just rely on the current structure that has not shown the innovation, adaptability and agility that has been shown in other regions of the United Kingdom, for instance in the Northern Powerhouse around Manchester, or even in the Republic of Ireland. And it is disappointing that in the draft programme for government framework that has 3 outcomes, 10 indicators and 11 measures, all about the economy, there are no real specific ideas for building this new economy. It's also concerning, having fought hard to achieve the introduction rate of a lower rate of 12.5% corporation tax, that this central idea is not even mentioned in Outcome 1, where the draft programme for government talks about how we can prosper through a strong, competitive, regionally balanced economy. We, as the opposition, as with Northern Ireland businesses, as represented by the CBI, Manufacturing Northern Ireland, Northern Ireland Chamber of Commerce, the Institute of Directors, Unite and the other unions, and above all by the companies themselves, would need to see a proper joined-up manufacturing strategy that puts back towards our prosperity and future. So we should be setting targets. We should be making 20% of our GDP from manufacturing rather from the current level of 14%. This should be a hard, measurable target. We should benchmark the success or failure of our manufacturing strategy against other UK regions, such as Scotland, which is, of course, where the platform for government or the programme for government framework is sourced, from Wales, the Northern Powerhouse, and from the Republic of Ireland. Maybe indeed this could form the basis of an annual health check in all of our government departments that it can allow the people for Northern Ireland to see how our government is either over or underperforming. We would also welcome from the Minister a robust championing and defence of a series of pro-manufacturing approaches that will be transformative to our economy, especially around the issues of taxation, keeping business rates low, energy costs, maintaining security of supply, extended enterprise zones, improving infrastructure, and urgently addressing the shortage of skills that our innovative companies are facing. Specifically, we would suggest we need a couple of specific measures, particularly a coherent and stable tax structure built around the 12.5% corporation tax, delivered on time. And we should also be retaining the 30% cap rate on business rates, not just for the short term, but for the long term. We should also use the facilities of enterprise zones that I know the First Minister previously wasn't happy with. We need those in areas where Northern Ireland is being particularly challenged, and we need to grow on those and what we need to do. We also need to do something about our rather paltry research and development. We currently only put about a third of the UK total of research and development into what we're doing as we're going forward. We need to increase that to the average of the UK level, and what we're going to call for is a fund of approximately £1 billion over the next 20 years, which needs to be linked to business, the universities and industry. But we're very conscious of making unrealistic demands on an already taut budget. And what we can do is by closely examining how some of the money is spent on the underperforming quangos that we have around them, which we have a plethora. We need to divert funds from those and from other areas where we could support a proper Northern Ireland Regional Development Fund. And Europe could be critical in doing this and helping us as we go forward. But all this needs to be backed up by some more practical things. We need to address the high cost of energy of our manufacturing and agribusiness companies. But we must also rate that our energy sector requires considerable investment, with an ageing grid that is not capable of dealing with the demands of low-carbon generation. It needs a functioning north-south and east-west interconnectors to connect us to the growing all-islands energy market, and a regulator that delivers energy on a median cost to all-island cost. We have some of the highest energy costs in Europe. But we need to be able to match that. But most of all, we need to be able to match the energy costs in the Republic of Ireland, which are, in some places for the major sort of manufacturing companies, 16 to 17% less than we have. And we must question how, in an all-island energy market, our utility regulator mechanisms appears to deliver very little. There are some fundamental questions there that need to be asked. We also need to address the skills shortage and investment in higher education and further education. But we need to do it by listening to what our businesses need, as well as by promoting our previously mentioned research and development and what we're trying to do. We also need to deal with other business costs, sea and air transport, and asking the question why it's five times as expensive to cross the North Channel as it's across the English Channel. It's ridiculous to note that over a period of 25 years, it would probably be cheaper to build a tunnel under the North Channel than it would be to continue with these high costs. Equally, air passenger duty is a tax on business and should be addressed urgently to deal with that to deal with as well. Infrastructure, and particularly in the roads infrastructure, needs to be improved. Broadband has in some places in Northern Ireland has become a joke and needs to be sorted out. And again, we mentioned the smart grid. If we are to have a much more flexible and innovative economy, we need to make sure that the main fundamentals of that are available. We need proper road links to our major logistical hubs, and we need to do something about the other levels of infrastructure we have. But penultimately, we need to change the mindset. Manufacturing is not in a sunset period. Our 3,820 manufacturers at any scale can drive our future. Achieving a 20% manufacturing sector and generating an additional 100,000 jobs is achievable, but only we put it at the centre of making Northern Ireland work. And for that, we need vision, strategy, willingness from us all. And to make that happen, and it's too important to be delivered just by our government departments, we welcome the Minister creating a fully inclusive Northern Ireland Strategic Manufacturing Board, as happens in other areas of the United Kingdom and Europe, bringing together all the key partners to make it work, and with working with our stakeholders to rally to make Northern Ireland one of the best places for both manufacturing jobs as we go forward. But before I ask the Minister to respond to our calls for commissioning a proper manufacturing strategy for Northern Ireland, I think we need to address probably what is the biggest single issue that's affecting us on the future of business in Northern Ireland. Currently, we are planning to have a referendum in the United Kingdom on the future membership of the EU. Listening to the clarion calls from the business community, listening from the clarion calls from all our sort of many of our sort of business-led organisations, one of the most important things we're seeing at the moment is that there's a lack of certainty. There is a fear about the future. There's concerns, particularly about north, south, and east-west trade, and there's concerns about what our companies are going to face when they're going into the future. I think it's remarkable that if we look at this chamber here and the parties around this chamber here, the majority of the parties in this chamber would support the United Kingdom remaining within the EU. And I would like the Minister to make a statement on behalf of the government, which includes his party and another party, about what support we should be going to the people to Northern Ireland and saying we should remain in the EU, because that is indeed the best place for us in the future and the best place for us to be able to deliver a proper manufacturing strategy for the future. Thank you very much indeed.
I call Mr. Gordon Lyons to move the amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. And first of all, can I congratulate the member for South Antrim on his maiden speech. I look forward to working with him in the Economy Committee and on these issues as we move forward. I also want to congratulate the Minister on his appointment, and we're very pleased that he is in post, very pleased that we have the Department for the Economy, and we want to wish him well for the future. Also want to make note that I think it is important that this debate has been on the issue of manufacturing. I welcome that focus. I think it's important that we are bringing these issues to the fore, debating them, talking about them, and sending the message out there as well that these are issues that we are concerned about and that these are issues that we believe need to be addressed. Mr. Speaker, we have tabled an amendment to the member's motion. Although we welcome the focus on manufacturing, we do seek the approval of the House to amend the motion. But before I come on to that, I think it would be useful for us to have a look at manufacturing in Northern Ireland and the current state of play. And there's no doubt that there have been an awful lot of difficulties over the last number of years for manufacturing. It has impacted on our constituents, particularly in my own constituency. I have many people who have worked in Ballymena. We think of Michelin and we think of JTI and the job losses that have taken place there. And it is important that we recognise that these aren't just figures that we're talking about. These are real people who have lost their jobs and find themselves in a very difficult situation. And we should be doing all that we can in our power, not only to sustain the jobs that we have here in Northern Ireland, but make sure that we create more as well. So there's no doubt that there are many challenges that the manufacturing sector is facing at this time. However, it's not an insignificant sector. It's not an insignificant part of our economy. As Mr. Aiken, the member for South Antrim, has already said, it's responsible for 85,000 jobs directly, and it supports over 100,000 more. £213 million in export sales, hundreds of millions of pounds of foreign direct investment. Manufacturing is also responsible for some of our best paid and most highly skilled jobs in Northern Ireland. And although there have been challenges, although there have been difficult times, we should be welcoming the fact that there has been growth within the sector over recent years. And indeed, we have seen thousands of extra jobs added in the manufacturing sector since the downturn. And as well as having growth, we're also growing at a faster rate than the rest of the UK, despite us having an already larger than average manufacturing sector in comparison to the rest of the United Kingdom. So although the picture in terms of manufacturing has challenges, it is not a bleak picture, it is not a picture without hope. We bring the amendment on the list to the House because we are committed as a party to creating more and better jobs in Northern Ireland, and we welcome the fact that we're going to have the opportunity to have another debate on the economy tomorrow and talk further about plans for an economic strategy. And this will require work, not only in manufacturing, but across the whole economy and across whole sectors. And as a result, we're focusing on a new economic strategy and a refocused economic strategy to deliver growth for the whole economy. And yes, manufacturing should be at the centre of that, and we hope that that will be the case. So we're proposing this amendment today. Why are we asking for, instead of just a single manufacturing strategy? I'll give way on that point.
Thank the member for giving way, and the member is right to talk about a holistic approach. But as I heard the previous speaker say about infrastructure, would you realise that infrastructure has been heavily damaged in Northern Ireland because of the Tory cuts, a party that was wedded to the UUP for many years? And would the member like me want to know where the UUP stands in the European Union, whether they're in or out? Because at the minute we don't really know where they stand.
Well, the member has an extra minute.
I look forward to Mr. Swan winding up the debate, and he'll be able to answer these questions. My opinion on this is that perhaps the Ulster Unionist Party is not united on this issue. Perhaps some people have seen the light and have realised that we would be better off out of the European Union. But I'll not speak for the Ulster Unionist Party. I will let Mr. Swan answer that question, and no doubt the chamber will be full when he makes his remarks so that we can get some clarity on this issue. But we do want to see growth in the whole economy, and we want to see growth, obviously, in manufacturing. But growth in the whole economy will help manufacturing as well, and that's what we want to see. That's why we want to see an economic strategy for all of Northern Ireland and across all sectors. But, of course, there is overlap as well, isn't there, between different sectors and different businesses within our economy. If we think of some of the issues that are brought up to us, issues that people raise, it's about rates, infrastructure, skills and education, energy, competitiveness, investment. All of these issues come together. And although not all businesses or all companies may have issues with all of these different problems that they may face, together we need to address them all. And as my colleague Mr. Frew has said, perhaps we do need to have a more holistic approach in regards to this. And we think the best way in which we can deliver for Northern Ireland on these issues is through one strategy. Because, of course, the challenges that are facing manufacturing are not unique to manufacturing. That doesn't mean, of course, that we will not have an absence, I hope, of help or targets or actions in regards to manufacturing within that. And certainly you will all be avid readers of the DUP manifesto from the 2016 Assembly election, something that was endorsed by the people of Northern Ireland, and we make it very clear in that document that we want to see manufacturing put at the very heart of the economic strategy. I think as well it's also useful for us to have that one strategy for us as backbenchers and as opposition parties to hold the government to account to say here's one single document, here's what the executive have said that they were going to do, and it's useful in my mind to have that codified in one document. And so I hope that I've been able to outline for the House why it is that we are seeking to have this amendment brought before the House, and we hope that it will get the support of it. But as we move forward, there are steps that need to be taken, and Mr. Aiken has rightly outlined some of the things that we want to see happen. And we hope that there will be focus on issues such as skills. Hugely important as we move forward that we have our people trained and educated and with the right skills for the jobs that are coming along, especially in light of the devolution of corporation tax powers, something that is going to be hugely important for Northern Ireland, something that has the potential to create thousands of jobs. And I know that not everybody agrees in terms of what we have done in regards to the devolution of corporation tax. I think it was the Ulster Unionist Party said it was time to move on from this issue a few years ago and said it was time for Plan B. I'm glad that we stuck to Plan A and that we have the devolution of corporation tax. And we not only have the power devolved, but we've also set a date and a rate, and I think that is very important. And we also need to focus on energy. This is a massive issue, again, not only just for those in manufacturing, but in other businesses as well. And we need to be looking at that and seeing how we can have energy that is cheap or certainly cheaper than what we have at the minute, and that we can provide that help to industry and to businesses. And of course, we have mentioned, or it has been mentioned already, about infrastructure and the need that we have the proper infrastructure in place as well. So I hope, Mr. Speaker, that I've been able to outline to the House the reasons for our amendment. We look forward to working with other parties within this Assembly to bring forward this economic strategy that can deliver real, tangible results for the people of Northern Ireland and create a more prosperous future for us all. Thank you.
I call the Chair of the Committee for the Economy, Mr. Conor Murphy.
I'm delighted to, as the chairperson of the Economy Committee, to participate in this debate, which has been brought forward by the Deputy Chair. And of course, while I'm speaking as the Chair of the Committee, members will be aware that we have only met once, so we hadn't had the opportunity to discuss a potential manufacturing strategy for the North or what such a strategy should look like. However, speaking on behalf of the Committee, I can assure the House that we will debate fully. And we won't be found wanting when it comes to listening to stakeholders, discussing among ourselves, and indeed providing ideas to the Minister for such a strategy to be brought forward. It may have been better, I suppose, if we had had some of that discussion before the debate was brought forward today. But having said that, I'm sure that the contributions of today's debate will feed in to the committee's discussion, and that we will look in a very proactive way at kind of providing a pathway which not only supports our existing manufacturing industries, but that we also seek to develop new industries as well. I don't think anyone here is naive enough to assume that we can develop a strategy for the North which ignores the realities of the global economy and the balances and links between our economy and that of the South, that of Britain, and that of the EU. But we are aware, as members, and particularly those whose constituencies were affected, of the announcement of large-scale job losses at the likes of Michelin, Gallagher's, Bombardier, Seagate and others, and of course everyone would share the view that we cannot afford to lose these types of skilled jobs. So I'll be advocating that the committee takes a measured view of the potential benefits of a dedicated manufacturing strategy for the North and what it might contain. Should there be a consensus around such a strategy, the committee will want to ensure that it's the right fit for us here and not simply imported from elsewhere. I suggest that the committee will want to look at what disadvantages our additional cost burdens, and the previous speakers have mentioned some of those, that we face, which competitors in other regions don't, and how might those be best offset through the work of a strategy and indeed the work of the executive. And the committee will also have to consider whether our job promotion model facilitates the development of manufacturing jobs here. Additionally, we must also consider whether jobs in manufacturing may be more secure in long term than jobs, for instance, in high-tech industries or creative industries, and are we promoting jobs strategically over a range of sectors? At its first meeting last week, the issue of energy costs was raised, and it has been mentioned, by the previous speakers here, and clearly there's a particular concern for 20 or 30 of our largest manufacturers, and we should also consider then, as has been alluded to, how the proposed lowering of our corporation tax rate in 2018 will impact on the situation for manufacturers. So the development of a specific manufacturing strategy for the North may require a fundamental redesign of InvestNI, and these are all questions that must be considered, and the committee obviously would be a key player in any process of developing such a strategy, and I know that we wouldn't, I know from listening to the committee members last Wednesday, that we won't be backward about bringing ideas to the table in that regard. I do think it would be unwise to engage in a hastily developed strategy simply to respond to the large-scale job losses that we've had. But I think, as the amendment suggests, quite clearly, any such manufacturing strategy, and I think the proposer of the motion would probably accept this from his contribution, that it's located firmly within an economic strategy which is located firmly within the broader programme for government. And that then is aligned with a budget which can actually deliver on such a strategy, and I think that's the logical way to go forward. Speaking on my own behalf, Cian Corla, I would obviously want to see any strategy which promotes and supports and encourages new manufacturing industries to be one which is regionally balanced as well, and that is already alluded to in the Programme for Government framework document that's going out, but the need for regional balance right across the six counties. And clearly also, I think, in developing such a strategy, it's not simply a matter for ourselves here, But as the programme for government itself, in the way it's now been designed, and it will be rolled out over the autumn period, this is a matter where we need engagement with all of the stakeholders, the people in the manufacturing industries, the trade unions, the manufacturing trade unions, who are at the coalface of these industries, need to be part of developing such a strategy. And only on the basis of feedback right across all of those sectors and consideration of the bigger issues that are facing manufacturing, that are discouraging investment and job creation, and that may be within our gift to try and assist in a greater spread of job creation across the manufacturing industries, then in doing, taking all of those matters into account,
I believe that
we can come up with a strategy which is located within the economic strategy and is backed by a budget through the programme for government.
As this is Sinead Bradley's first opportunity to speak as a private member, I would remind the House that it is the convention that the speech is made without interruption. That may be forfeited, of course, if you become ultra-controversial. I remind the member.
I'll attempt not to, Mr. Speaker. Thank you very much. As you indicated, it is my maiden speech to the House, and I would like to direct my first comments to thank the people of South Down who have given me the privilege of being here and representing them. And it's a great honour for me to add my name to a list of SDLP party representatives who have served the people of South Down, namely the late Eddie McGrady, my own father, PJ Bradley, Eamon O'Neill, Margaret Ritchie, MP, and in the last mandate, Karen McKevitt and Sean Rogers. Like each of those former members, I will endeavour to make sure South Down is very well represented in this House, and I look forward to working with others for the betterment of the people of Northern Ireland. But I will share with you, openly, my hope that this chapter of politics in Northern Ireland will be remembered in South Down as the time when the Narrow Water Bridge was finally delivered. Nothing short of this would bring satisfactory closure to the lifetime's political work my father, PJ Bradley, put towards this project. Moving on to the business in front of us today, I welcome the opportunity to contribute to the debate on the need to develop a manufacturing strategy for Northern Ireland. Many base factors are essential for a balanced growth of all sectors across our economy. These include things that have already been mentioned, such as access to a healthy and skilled workforce, the development of reliable and competitive sources of energy, infrastructure, etc. No doubt there will be plenty of opportunities to discuss in detail many of these particular issues in an overarching economic agenda is being delivered for Northern Ireland. Today's motion, however, presents us with an opportunity to pay a particular focus on one sector within that economic offering, and that is the manufacturing sector. It is well documented that the manufacturing sector in Northern Ireland has suffered a number of blows during the past 12 months. Some already mentioned the loss of more than 1,000 jobs from Bombardier, similar cuts with Michelin, JTI Gallagher and lately Seagate. Manufacturing NI have recently warned that more than 6,000 jobs could be lost across the sector over the next decade due to advances in technology. Despite this, manufacturing continues to play a significant role in our overall economy. Many headline statistics can be found to illustrate just how significant. In my own constituency of South Down, major employers such as Bradford Limited, MGM Group and BE Aerospace are but only a few of the key manufacturing businesses supporting the economy. Manufacturing in Northern Ireland represents about 13-14% of GDP. The SDLP share in the manufacturing sector belief that it is possible and necessary for the executive to work with the sector to increase the contribution to 20% of GDP. They say, and I quote, "This would be possible with the implementation of a manufacturing strategy, the establishment of a target on competitive energy prices, continued stability on rates, and the raising of ambition." The amendment placed against the original motion here today sadly does not fill me with confidence that ambition has been raised. Make no mistake, this debate has the potential to represent a pivotal moment in the future direction of manufacturing here in Northern Ireland. Here today we see an opportunity to create a focused strategy that has the potential to navigate specific barriers of growth within the sector and help realise that desirable 20% of GDP. At a time when Europe openly seeks to reindustrialise, members of this House have yet to grasp the significance of needing a specific manufacturing strategy. I find it regrettable that I, through my maiden speech, have to try to convince others that a real need for a dedicated manufacturing strategy exists. I would have much preferred my contributions today to have focused on the ambitions of that strategy. In conclusion, Mr. Speaker, I will say the Northern Ireland Executive must formulate and implement a manufacturing strategy which the industry has been calling for more than a year. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Mr. Stephen Farry.
Mr. Speaker, and could I first of all congratulate Sinéad Bradley in terms of her maiden speech, and I have no doubt that she will follow in the footsteps of her predecessors in giving a very passionate voice for the people of South Down, and also to pass on congratulations to Mr. Aiken on his maiden speech, and also to the Minister on his appointment, obviously you, Mr. Speaker, in terms of your appointment as well. That's the protocol out of the way. Obviously, in terms of any discussion of manufacturing, as we meet particularly today with the referendum barely weeks ahead of us, that colours anything that is said in this chamber today about manufacturing. It is clearly in the interest of Northern Ireland that we remain part of the European Union, and in particular so for the manufacturing sector, that it really depends very much on exports and access to international markets for its current level of activity. And if we are to follow through in terms of the very laudable objectives in terms of increasing the share of our economy to manufacturing, it's only going to be through exports that will be realised. So being part of Europe is absolutely fundamental to the future of manufacturing here. It's also, I think, worth taking a moment to think as well about exactly what we're going to be doing in terms of manufacturing. It's important this issue doesn't become an issue of the precise architecture as to how strategies fit together, but more an issue about the commitments that people are going to be making to turn those into reality. Could also pass on my congratulations to the Ulster Unionist Party on their newfound appreciation of the value of strategies. As someone who listened in the past mandate to them bemoaning yet again another strategy, we demand action. Finally, they have recognised that a strategy is very useful for crystallising the vision, the aims and objectives, and also setting out the particular action points that will be taken, and crucially also the resourcing that will be set aside against those. And indeed, while Mr. Aiken read out a very important list of a number of different initiatives that can be taken to improve manufacturing, it is important that we also are mindful of the resources required to turn that into reality. And the only commitment I heard to new resources was some minor tinkering in terms of quangos, and even the abolition of quangos doesn't produce a huge amount of additional resource, because the functions of quangos still have to be addressed elsewhere in the system. So it's important that whenever we are talking about the steps that are required, that we are putting in place the resources to ensure that they come forward. And if we are talking today about this historic moment of opposition, or even constructive opposition isn't just about being opposition with a nice smile. It's also about having a clear alternative and ensuring that alternative is actually feasible and something that can be properly resourced. I do recognise that manufacturing in Northern Ireland is going through some challenging times, and there's been a lot of negative headlines and bad news stories, in particular over the past 12 months. But at the same time, I think it's important that we do recognise that while there is serious scope for growth, that we do have a healthy situation, and employment in manufacturing is currently at a level exceeding the figures far back as 2008, and we have many strengths. I think what we are seeing is an evolution in terms of our manufacturing sector or sectors in terms of a move to more high-value-added jobs, and that does involve some bad news at the same time as we're having good news in terms of new jobs being created. In terms of the architecture itself, I see the choice between the motion and the amendment as being a very false binary choice. I think it's important that we recognise that manufacturing must be very much central to any new or refreshed economic strategy, but there may well be scope for doing additional work, more detailed work, outside the very particular confines of the economic strategy. That strategy itself will make references to other strategies. For example, we have a current skills strategy, a STEM strategy, we have other particular issues around skills. Indeed, whenever we look to manufacturing, we will see a range of different interventions in terms of very particular subsections of manufacturing, whether it's life sciences or IT, and indeed Invest NI have a number of initiatives in that regard already. It's also important we recognise that manufacturing is actually very diverse. It ranges from things like life sciences through to plastics, heavy engineering. There's also an ongoing debate as to whether agri-food is actually part of manufacturing. Some people count it as part of manufacturing, some don't. Of course, we have a separate strategy there in terms of going for growth already. So it's important that we have that proper round of discussion with the business community and indeed those particularly in manufacturing as to how best we can serve their interests and keep an open mind as to what the best set structures is going to be in that regard. So I regard this as being a false choice, but I do believe there is scope for us doing something particularly focused at manufacturing in that broadest sense, accepting that we have to recognise there will be particular sub-strategies plus the overarching economic strategy. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I call Mr. Mervyn Storey.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker, and regrettably I can't stand here today and say this is my maiden speech since I've been here since 2003. However, in all those years, still, we have in Northern Ireland much that we need to be proud of. And it does disappoint me when I come to this House, and I've said this repeatedly in previous debates, that it seems as though we always want to find ourselves in a position where we concentrate on the negatives. And it's all about, of course, we now have a new opposition, well, one of four or five or six or seven, I'm not sure how many leaders of the opposition there are now. But I think it's time that this Assembly, and I would give some advice, if they would be so kind to take it to, whether it's the official opposition or whoever it is in that corner, to actually talk up Northern Ireland. Let's remember that in our manufacturing, we have 214,000 direct and supported jobs, one in four of all jobs in the economy. We have 9.9 billion total GVA contribution to GDP, around 30% of the economy. Productivity at 55,700 is 38% higher than the Northern Ireland average, with advanced manufacturing contribution of 27% more. So those are the figures for manufacturing Northern Ireland. Yet when we come to this House, it is all about what more we need to do. And not one speaker today has yet actually paid tribute to the manufacturing base that we do have, and pay tribute to those many 214,000 direct and supported jobs in terms of how they have contributed to the well-being of Northern Ireland. Now, it's not perfect. There's a huge amount of work still to be done. And I think that, particularly coming from Northumberland, I know all too well the impact of what it is when there are job losses. And we have made reference, and I thank members for the references that have been made to the closure in relation to JTI and Michelin, and the pressures that there are even on our manufacturing companies such as Wrightbus, and the challenges that they face on a day and daily basis to underwrite and to secure the long-term future of those jobs. I pay tribute to companies that have recently come into my constituency in Ballymoney, such as Terex, a global company, a global organisation, which I believe needs to continue to be supported. Indeed, I just recently met with them, and I do agree with the issue that was raised by the member and others about the cost of our energy, and I have no doubt that my colleague, the Minister, and I pay tribute to him and wish him well in his new role, will give this as an area of priority. But let me come to an issue that was also raised by the member, and I'm glad to be on the Economy Committee with him and look forward to working with him. I've no doubt we will have our differences. I no doubt we will have our political spats, as you wouldn't expect anything else from politicians. However, he raises the issue about the coming referendum. I would like the member to ask those companies in Northern Ireland who have been curtailed, who have been restrained, who have been, in many respects, set at a disadvantage because of our attachment to the European Union. The regulations that are destroying, that are crippling the advantage that our companies could have in terms of the way in which they provide their services. Indeed, I would ask the Deputy Chair of the Committee and the proposer of the debate today if he could speak to his colleague, Mr. Swan, and ask him what his view on this issue is, because of course we know that, as has been already alluded to, the Ulster Unionist Party, not for the first time on a number of issues, is divided on this issue. But my party are very clear, and if you heard my colleague Sammy Wilson on this morning, let's deal with facts and not fear. Let's deal with the reality of where we are. And I think it's regrettable that our Chancellor came to Northern Ireland today and was about bringing fear to the debate, as opposed to bringing the facts to the debate in relation to, let's make sure that in the future, our manufacturing base, and also Mr. Farrey makes a very valid point, it is a diverse environment in which manufacturing operates, and we need to ensure that in our terminology, in our policy, in our strategy, and in everything that we do, that we have ensured that we have covered all the areas appropriately so that we continue to build on the success and make Northern Ireland the economic powerhouse that I believe it can become.
Well, Mr. Tom Buchanan.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. And again, I rise to support the amendment before the House today. And at the very outset, can I congratulate my colleague Simon Hamilton on his appointment to the Minister for the Economy and wish him every success in his new role. It's one which I am confident that he will lead this country forward to even greater success and prosperity. So I want to wish him well. Northern Ireland is no stranger to being a world leader on the manufacturing stage. This country has been built on a firm foundation of manufacturing, and this small but powerful nation has a rich history in manufacturing, innovation and entrepreneurship. The foundation has stayed firm through the centuries, and Northern Ireland has thrived in spite of obstacles on a national and a more recent international scale. And it is fair to say that in recent years, cuts to the manufacturing sector right across Northern Ireland and a climate of instability did lead to some very challenging circumstances and times for the industry. Yet I believe that it is now time, and the opportunity has here within Northern Ireland, to rise again to the manufacturing excellence and show the strength again that we have on a global scale. Northern Ireland, we already have the right ingredients in place to ensure that this long-term vision for the future not only comes together but thrives on a global scale. It is imperative that we as a government come up with the long-term strategic policies that empower Northern Ireland to believe in its own strength. Through the mix of all the ingredients, the manufacturing sector will have the tools to become more competitive globally. And it is only through close partnership with the industry that we can create a highly skilled workforce which can deal with the dynamic nature of this rapidly changing sector. However, this is only one strand of the partnership. There must be flexibility within government to bring leaders from across the manufacturing sector to share ideas to ensure that we move forward in the right direction. Indeed, it is this type of collaboration between government, industry and education which is the vehicle to steer us toward a more efficient and streamlined manufacturing sector and moving forward. A vital ingredient in the future economic strategy, which includes manufacturing, is skills. If we are serious about improving economic prosperity of our region, we need to build on the good work which was started in the previous Dale Department in investment in science, technology, engineering and MLAs. is crucial to empower our young people to have the skills which we need to build up the manufacturing sector within our country. In conjunction with empowering our young people with appropriate skills, research and development in the industry is a fundamental force which will drive the economy forward. For manufacturing to be successful amongst many other sectors, research and development must be at the cutting edge of growth and preparation for the future. We already have two world-class universities here, and with the wealth of knowledge which are already informed by the industry. Skills exchange and sharing between education and industry needs to be the hinge on which our strategy swings to improve and grow our sectors within Northern Ireland. Fundamental foundational industries such as energy companies, investment into long-term projects which meets manufacturing energy needs are also essential. And one of the big areas is broadband provision, which needs to be enhanced. If I look at my own constituency in West Tyrone, there is very poor broadband provision in some areas, and this can have a devastating impact on companies and is a real factor in businesses who are trying to compete on the global market. Even within such poor infrastructure, however, we have to say that manufacturing and industry continues to strive. Precision engineering is a niche market in the West Tyrone area and is thriving and growing. This is one example of where the skills and attitude of businesses in the manufacturing industry can adapt and be world leaders despite the difficulties across the sector. Mr. Speaker, manufacturing excellence does not necessarily equate to business success. As a government, we need to be smart and to think more like a business. We must provide strong links within a global market and make it much easier for companies to access those markets and do all in their power to ensure that this happens, and I support the amendment.
Call Mr. Patsy McGlone.
Thanks very much, Mr. Speaker. The SDLP supports the motion and its objective. The Minister for the Economy should take the lead in developing a manufacturing strategy in collaboration with his executive colleagues. And the relevance and importance of that is, in fact, that it needs to be joined up in a multifaceted way. Economic development, indeed, is heavily reliant upon our skills base, but not only that, our infrastructural base. And that includes, yes, roads, it includes water. It's already been referred to. It also includes the network, the grid, and, crucially, broadband and all that goes with the attendant communications network, which are so frequently used now by businesses to help develop and promote their companies. The introduction of the current executive's draft programme for government framework talks about finalising and agreeing the programme for government, the budget, a refreshed economic strategy, a new investment strategy and a social strategy by the end of 2016. It doesn't talk about a manufacturing strategy. In fact, manufacturing is noticeable by its absence in the executive's framework document, whilst other sectors, such as tourism, get numerous mentions. This is a mistake. And yes, we've had reference to the corporation tax, but key to the success or otherwise of corporation tax is, of course, stability. And that stability includes our position within the EU. And I heard Mr. Storey made reference earlier to his colleague on the Nolan Show this morning, who did refer to the likes of Sweden and Norway, and indeed France and Switzerland, in the context of the preferred option for relationships within these islands and indeed with the EU. It might be helpful if indeed he placed those things in the proper context and a factual record and brought the cogency of that argument up to date, and rather than talking about how things were as he wished they were, rather than as they are. However, back to the key element of the manufacturing strategy. The recent announced job losses at Seagate and Derry, Sirocco Engineering, Michelin, the closure of JTI plant in Ballymena, and the Bombardier statement of intent to reduce their workforce demonstrates the difficulties that the manufacturing sector is facing. Both workers' representatives and employers in the manufacturing sector have consistently called for a specific manufacturing strategy to be put in place by the executive. They may differ on some of the details, but they are united in seeking the development of a comprehensive executive strategy to support and grow the manufacturing sector. Unite have previously joined with the Manufacturing Employers Group, Manufacturing NI. I'm sure many of us have already dealt with both groups and worked with them closely in the past, to call on the Northern Ireland Executive to commit to a manufacturing strategy. In November last year, they called for urgent action to protect our manufacturing base and help create the conditions to allow manufacturers to grow. In April this year, the General Secretary of the Irish Congress of Trade Unions, Patricia King, called for the incoming Northern Ireland Executive to put forward a comprehensive manufacturing strategy to tackle issues such as have been referred to, energy costs, skills development and support for investment. And in March this year, Manufacturing NI published a report by Oxford Economics on the economic contribution of manufacturing here and called on this executive to raise ambitions and to drive reindustrialisation of our economy. Just this week, Manufacturing NI and the Unite Union once again joined together in support of the motion which we are debating here today, and I do hope there is serious support and deliberation given to it. What is clear from the Oxford Economics report is that despite the difficulties I mentioned, the manufacturing sector outperforms every other part of our economy. It delivers 214,000 direct and supported jobs, very positive message, one in four of all jobs in the economy. 85,000 people are directly employed in manufacturing. It is the largest single employment sector in my constituency of Mid-Ulster. Manufacturing delivers a 9.9 billion total gross value added contribution to GDP, around 30% of the economy. Productivity at 55,700 is 38% higher than Northern Ireland's average, with advanced manufacturing contribution 25% higher still than that. Manufacturing accounts for almost two-thirds of all export sales, some £6 billion. Manufacturers invested £254 million in R&D in 2014, and the manufacturing sector attracted £900 million in foreign direct investment between 2010 and 2014. There's clearly room for improvement, and, Mr Speaker, I support that the motion as it stands. Thank you.
I call Mr Jim Mallister.
Speaker, I trust you will be rebuking the Member for North Belfast, the Chief Whip of Sinn Féin, for a flagrant breach of the protocols and courtesies of this House when she walked in front of the last Speaker between you and he when he was speaking. Could I say this? No economy can hope to succeed and to grow without the engine house that is the manufacturing industry. Yes, service industry and everything else has its place, but without manufacturing providing the strong backbone which grows an economy, then no economy will reach its potential. And therefore, manufacturing is central to the growth of our economy or any other. And yes, it's good to hear sound bites about prosperity in the manufacturing sector, and I'm not putting the manufacturing sector down in any way, but I do have to be mindful, representing North Antrim, of the context in my constituency of two dire blows in the devastating losses at JTI and at Mitcham. And it would be nice today if the Minister had something positive to tell us about the replacement of those jobs in North Antrim. This would be a timely occasion within this House, not outside it, within this House to do that. And we live in hope in that regard. I want to address a couple of the major shackles that are upon our manufacturing. And it is my hope that come the 23rd of June, some of those shackles will be cut because we will be liberated from the restraints of being within the European Union. Because it is a fact that though only 17% of manufacturing businesses in Northern Ireland export to the EU, every manufacturing business is subject to the same market restraints, the same regulations, the same Brussels restraints as apply across the market, as if they were all exporting when they're not. And of course, one of the consequences of leaving the EU would be to liberate instantly those businesses which for 40 years have been subject to unnecessary EU regulation, even though they never exported to the EU. One of the follies of membership of the EU is that all your business is subject to the regulations as if they exported, even though they don't. And of course, the greater bulk of our produce is either sold locally or is sold to GB, and in manufacturing export terms, only a quarter of our produce is actually exported to other EU countries. And yet we are subject to the entirety of that burden and restraint. And the second reason why for manufacturing, I hope the people of the United Kingdom have the good sense to leave the EU, is that it will liberate us in terms of trade. As a nation, the minority of our trade is with the EU. The growth in our trade is with the growth parts of the world outside the EU. And yet, because we're in the EU, we're not permitted as a nation to make a single trade agreement with any of the countries with which our trade is growing. And therefore, our hand is tied behind our back in consequence of growing our trade, in consequence of our membership of the EU. So far from the scare stories and the scaremongering and the ludicrous things that from the Chancellor down and the Prime Minister have been said, the 23rd of June presents a marvellous opportunity for manufacturing, for industry, for this society to liberate itself from the dead hand of Brussels, to free ourselves from that moribund part of the developing of the world, the EU, and to follow the growth which is outside. And if we do that, our manufacturing has a prosperous future rather than one hindered by the present regulations of Brussels.
Point of order.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker. Just to give my apologies for walking past Patsy McGlone, and to accept Patsy, my apologies for walking in front. I don't think there's any need to, you know, conduct a whole investigation and a protocol. Just if you wouldn't mind, just accept my apologies. Thank you very much.
Apologies noted. I do draw all members' attention to the fact that when a member is on his feet, you ought not to walk in front of him or her. We are in early days, but let's adhere to the procedure. Minister for the Economy, Mr. Simon Hamilton. And the Minister has 15 minutes.
Thank you, Mr. Speaker. Mr. Speaker, I welcome the opportunity to respond to today's debate. Can I congratulate those members, including the proposer of the motion, on their maiden speeches? And can I thank members for their own kind words about my appointment? I'm very glad, Mr. Speaker, that the first debate in this new Assembly is focused on the economy, and I think it shows the centrality of what is my new department in terms of taking Northern Ireland forward. There is, Mr. Speaker, something of a perception that Northern Ireland's manufacturing sector is in the doldrums. I understand this, and perhaps it's because of the demise of many of our traditional heavy industries over the last number of decades. Industries like shipbuilding and textiles are either gone completely or they're a shadow of their former selves. Decisions by JTI and Michelin, which were referred to several times today, to close our plants in Ballymena, along with the news of 1,000 job losses at Bombardier and more recently job losses at Seagate and Londonderry, are not only devastating to those who are directly affected, they also exacerbate this belief that manufacturing in Northern Ireland is in poor shape. That perception, Mr. Speaker, does not tally with a careful analysis of the actual performance of the sector. Whether it is jobs, sales, exports or output, our manufacturing sector is actually performing very well. Figures for 2015 show that employment in the sector is now at 80,000 people. This is the first time since 2008 that the sector has had 80,000 jobs. Sales by manufacturing firms in 2014 stood at £18.1 billion, an increase of 1.7% on the previous year. Manufacturing exports in 2015 were £6.3 billion, up £350 million on 2014. And manufacturing output is up 2.4% in the last year. Northern Ireland's manufacturing sector has been outperforming the rest of the UK, with output since 2009 up by 19% compared to 6.9% across the whole of the United Kingdom. If manufacturing was indeed in decline, then none of those statistics would be showing the improvements that they are. I wouldn't for a second, Mr. Speaker, suggest that this isn't a sector that is challenged, but it isn't in the crisis that some would suggest. I, for one, am proud of the many achievements and successes of our manufacturing companies. The fact that one in three of London's red buses are made at Wright Bus in Ballymena, that 40% of the world's mobile crushing and screening equipment is made in Northern Ireland, that over 30% of the world's airline seats are manufactured at BAE Aerospace in Kilkeel, that 1 in 10 cholesterol tests worldwide are made by Randox, and that a quarter of all computer read-write heads are made at the aforementioned Seagate. I want to make it clear that, as Minister for the Economy, and as encouraged by Mr. Storey in his contribution, I will always be a champion and a cheerleader for local industry. I won't be sticking my head in the sand and denying that there are difficulties, but neither will I talk down any sector and seek to suggest that a crisis exists when it doesn't. Manufacturing is and will remain a crucial and central part of our local economy. It accounts for 11% of all of Northern Ireland's jobs and contributes 16% to the total economic output. While there have been some bad news with job losses, there have also been good news in the manufacturing sector with, for example, 110 jobs announced at CDE Global in Cookstown back in March. And it is encouraging that the Economic Policy Centre at Ulster University forecasts that employment growth in manufacturing will account for around 10% of the 40,000 additional jobs in the local economy over the period to 2025. There are, Mr. Speaker, many who will call upon my department to provide support for the manufacturing sector, so it might be useful if I were to sketch out some of the assistance given in recent years. In the last programme for government period, so 2011 to 2016, InvestNI provided £270 million of assistance to manufacturing businesses. This in turn unlocked £1.9 billion of total investment and created over 13,000 new jobs. To compete in the global economy, it is vital that Northern Ireland has in place a strong and efficient route for the delivery of high-level professional and technical skills, a point made by, I'm sure, by the, and will repeatedly be made, I'm sure, by my predecessor as Skills Minister. My department is in the process of implementing major reforms initiated in the last term of Northern Ireland's professional and technical education and training landscape through a new system of apprenticeships and youth training. Another way in which we have been supporting manufacturing is through the Competence Centre programme. This helps to facilitate and encourage knowledge exchange between industry and academia in collaborative programmes in connected health, sustainable energy, advanced engineering and agri-foods. This work will support the development and commercialisation of new technologies. InvestNI has committed £5 million of funding per centre over 5 years. Currently, 85 companies are participating across the four competence centres and 43 collaborative projects have been initiated. The Executive as a whole has continued to keep in place the policy of industrial derating, which provides businesses, including many manufacturing ones, with a 70% reduction in their rates bill. This policy has kept over £300 million in the pockets of local businesses in the last 5 years. Business costs, Mr. Speaker, are an important aspect of Northern Ireland's competitiveness. Research has shown that on balance, even when taking into account some areas where we have higher prices, we are a highly cost-competitive location compared with the rest of the United Kingdom and the Republic of Ireland. Overall, it has been estimated that business costs were typically about 84% of those in the whole of the UK and 95% of those in the Republic of Ireland, driven mainly by lower labour and property costs. I'm well aware that there are, for some of our larger companies, energy costs are a significant component of overall manufacturing costs. But we should remember that the cost challenges for the sector do not solely relate to energy. I'm grateful to the Energy and Manufacturing Advisory Group for its comprehensive report and recommendations on actions that might be taken to alleviate energy cost pressures for the sector. Energy markets are complex and actions taken in one area can have unintended consequences elsewhere. The group's report serves to illustrate these points with a diverse range of policy and operational recommendations. I and my department are closely looking at the recommendations that have been put forward, and it will be important to give careful consideration to the EMAG recommendations in the context of the wider strategic landscape and the department's work to review and refocus the strategic energy framework. Mr. Speaker, the focus of this motion is the call for a manufacturing strategy. I am not convinced that a standalone manufacturing strategy is the right thing for Northern Ireland, and let me try to explain why. My department is currently leading on the development of a refocused economic strategy which will accompany the final version of the programme for government. A key component of informing this refocus is a strong and robust evidence base. Matrix, which is the Northern Ireland Science Industry Panel, was created to provide advice and guidance on the high-tech business sectors and emerging market opportunities that we should exploit to make a major impact on economic growth in Northern Ireland. Matrix has, to date, identified a number of strategic subsectors within major global markets which we will look to further exploit. These subsectors, which are mainly manufacturing-based, are within the broader global markets of telecoms and ICT, life and health sciences, agri-food, advanced materials and advanced engineering. As a small region, Northern Ireland does not have the scale to be able to compete in every aspect of these markets, and that is why Matrix drills down to identify areas of particular strength and opportunity. So, for example, in life and health sciences, we will seek to exploit capability in key subsectors like precision medicine, clinical trials, diagnostics and health data analytics, all of which are, of course, areas with high-end manufacturing capabilities. This level of attention to key subsectors has also ensured that we are well-placed to know our technology strengths and market capabilities in the context of European smart specialisation. Indeed, it is widely considered that Northern Ireland has the most detailed understanding of its leading industries and therefore key manufacturing subsectors of any UK region. That gives our economic policy in this area considerable focus, and we are continuing to build on this evidence base all the time. Matrix's work also reflects the fact that sectors are increasingly dependent upon one another. In fact, some of the most important emerging opportunities are in spaces where sectors overlap. So we must not forget, for example, that services and manufacturing have become increasingly intertwined, and we now have many professionals such as software engineers, designers, accountants and scientists working within the manufacturing sector, and it is appropriate to look at all industries collectively while considering a strategy to grow the private sector. Our manufacturing base is, because of our strong history of manufacturing, still very diverse. There are activities ranging from aerospace, automotive, electronics, pharmaceuticals and chemicals to heavy plant machinery, agri-tech equipment and construction products, to name but a few. So you'll appreciate, Mr. Speaker, that there is not a one-size-fits-all support solution. What will work for the small firm cutting and welding and making farm trailers is very different from what will work for the company manufacturing sophisticated composite components for the aerospace sector. It is important that this diversity is recognised, and I believe the best way government can help is to create the environment which allows manufacturing companies to move forward with policies and support tailored in a way that maximises the benefit to the economy. So, in essence, for those looking for a strategy, we already have one. It's called the Economic Strategy, and it will be refreshed and refocused in line with the new PFG. I can assure the House that it will be highlighting the particular significance of manufacturing to the local economy, and it will set a clear direction for ensuring that the full gamut of appropriate policy instruments are in place to support the sector, namely a pipeline of talent to meet the skills needs of the sector now and in the future, investment in economic infrastructure, a support environment for innovation and knowledge exchange, business growth support measures, assistance with market development and exporting, and a regulatory environment that is good for business as well as protecting the interests of employees. Before I close, I want to say that I am delighted, Mr. Speaker, that we now have a date and a rate for the devolution of corporation tax, a rate of 12.5% effective from 2018 will provide a major stimulus for the economy and will provide support for all sectors. I am confident that the ability to lower the rate of corporation tax will help grow the entire private sector, including the manufacturing sector, as we seek to rebalance the Northern Ireland economy towards greater private sector and value-added growth. Mr. Speaker, to summarise, while I recognise that manufacturing has experienced some recent setbacks, the sector remains at the very heart of business and industry in Northern Ireland. Our region's strong manufacturing heritage remains intact, with a higher percentage concentration of manufacturing businesses in Northern Ireland than in the UK as a whole. We can remain confident that it will continue to have a significant role to play in the Northern Ireland economy as we seek to meet the challenges of global competitiveness. The debate today has been informative, and I can support the amendment that calls for the development of the manufacturing sector to be fully considered and reflected in the Executive's refocused economic strategy. Thank you, Mr. Speaker.
I too welcome the opportunity to speak on the amendment here today. And I also welcome the new Minister for the Economy, Simon Hamilton. to his post today and wish him well for his time in office, and I do trust he remembers the good people of North Down during that time. I believe the most productive way to go forward on this issue is to include the development of the manufacturing, as the Minister has said, in the Executive's new economic strategy, and that is why we have tabled this amendment today. Our manufacturing sector has been at the very backbone of our economy for many years. With our mixture of a very highly skilled, educated workforce combined with our rich industrial and enterprising heritage, we have a very proud and able sector which we all want to see flourish in the future. While challenges continue to exist, we do continue to see our economy continuing to recover from the global recession, which naturally had an impact upon our open economy. I am delighted that outcome one, number one in the draft programme for government is that we prosper through a strong, competitive, regionally balanced economy. This puts the economy in its rightful place as number one, right at the heart of our priorities for this country going forward in the future. The economy must continue to be the number one priority for our executive and indeed for InvestNI. Our manufacturing sector is vital in sustaining and growing our economy. We need to grow our private sector as we seek to rebalance our economy and seek to make Northern Ireland the number one place to do business and to invest in. Making the right conditions to improve our economic competitiveness and building on our export market are key to truly developing this sector. We must continue the preparatory work to get the conditions right on the ground for our new rate of cooperation tax, and I welcome the statement today by the Minister on that, and ensure we maximise the potential that this lever gives us for our manufacturing sector. It is vital we equip and train and skill our workforce to ensure we can compete for sustainable foreign direct investment and continue, as we must, to give robust support to InvestNI. Speaker, I now move to try and summarise some of the points made by the various speakers as I wind up this debate. Stephen Aitken, I think we would all commend him on his maiden speech, and he obviously wants to see change away from the public sector to the private sector, and he's registered his concern and the need for stronger economic growth. He also wants to see a joined-up manufacturing strategy, wants targets and benchmarking. I think that's important, that we have targets and benchmarking in place to see and monitor how we're doing. Also, he's made the point about the need for an uplift in R&D, something the committee has looked at, the old Dedi committee looked at in detail, the need for further support for R&D. My colleague Gordon Lyons made the point, and I think it's a very good point, that we need to continue to sustain the jobs that already exist within our province and ensure that proper funding is put in place to stop the leakage and to stop the losses that do happen. But I also recognise the growth, the continuing growth. We're growing faster than other parts of the UK. Conor Murphy, the chairman of the new Economy Committee, makes various points about the need for the support of a manufacturing strategy. But I think, to be fair, he recognises the need to engage with the committee in the future and with all stakeholders to try and come up with an inclusive strategy. Sinead Bradley, and I think we would commend her on her maiden speech as well, very impressive, and we all recognise the work of her father within this chamber and respect that work that he's done over the years. And I'm sure she'll work well with other members from South Down, namely our colleague Jim Wells and others. But she made the points about the need for strong support for the North Down, or for the South Down area, and the need for support for the local GDP, which is so important, and to put targets on competitive energy prices, I believe was the point she made, which I think is very important.
I understand. To conclude his remark.
Unfortunately, I have little time. Stephen Farrey, the former Dáil Minister, I think made very good points in relation to the need for upgrading our skills and recognising the different points Mr. Speaker, about whether the life sciences, engineering and agri sector be included. Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker.
Call Mr. Robin Swan to conclude and wind up on the debate, and the member has 10 minutes.
Thank you very much, Mr. Speaker, and it's a pleasure I stand to wind this first opposition debate of this new mandate in the Northern Ireland Assembly. And I can congratulate and thank my party colleague, Steve Egan, in bringing it forward. But what I would like to say is, especially some of the speakers from the left who tried to portray this debate and this motion as talking Northern Ireland down, it's far from it. I want to make that clear from the outset. I think, as Mr. Egan even said, that this wasn't about manufacturing being in a sunset in Northern Ireland. But that ambition and that drive, I think, was actually summed up in what Ms. Bradley said, when she seen this debate as that about the raising of ambition for the manufacturing industry in Northern Ireland. The Minister quoted statistics, but I think, as Mr. Egan pointed out, 13% of our GDP coming from manufacturing at this moment in time. If we can clearly have a target of 20% of GDP coming from manufacturing in Northern Ireland, I think that's something we should attain for, something we should strive for, and something that is recognised throughout all the stakeholders in Northern Ireland. And in the joint press release that was put out by Manufacturing NI and Unite the Union, very rarely do we see, Mr. Speaker, joint press releases coming from employers and unions about good news. The Unite the Union about this motion today, only a dedicated strategy will bring the focus and oversight necessary to ensure real action to meet the challenge facing our producers. Manufacturing NI, employers and trade unions have a vital role to play in terms of developing and overseeing delivery of such a strategy, and we stand ready to play that part. Now, both Manufacturing NI and Unite the Union asked every party in this Assembly to back this motion today for a single manufacturing strategy for Northern Ireland, and it's something they've long been calling for the past year and a half to 2 years. And it's something that I can't really, and I haven't got clarity on why the DUP and Sinn Féin have had that difficulty in a standalone manufacturing strategy, and in fact the amendment wanting to see it put as part of a new economic strategy. And I think it was actually Mr. Lyons' statement when he said he hoped to see manufacturing at the centre of that strategy. By proposing a standalone manufacturing, we want to ensure that manufacturing is given the place it duly deserves in the Northern Ireland economy. And I want to move on, Mr. Speaker, to some of the statistics that has been raised in the Chamber today, and they were raised by the Minister, you know, about the great successes we have in manufacturing and the current numbers that are employed, over 80,000 at this minute in time. But, Mr. Speaker, let's not be forgetful that those numbers still include the large numbers of people within my constituency who are still working for JTI, who are still working for Gallagher's, who haven't lost their jobs yet. There's blows and job losses coming to manufacturing and manufacturing employers that haven't been included in those statistics. So this motion isn't about talking down Northern Ireland manufacturing or portraying it as a state in crisis. It's about giving a reality to our new government to ensure that manufacturing is given its rightful place. And I hope that it's not buried within an economic strategy, but is given its rightful place. And I asked all members in the House today, no matter what they have committed to do, to actually listen to the stakeholders that are out there, because I think it's something Mr. Murphy made as committee chair for the Committee for the Economy, when his contribution said, as a committee, they wanted to listen to all the stakeholders. Two of the major stakeholders in manufacturing have spoken, Manufacturing NI and Unite the Union, and have made it clear they want a standalone manufacturing strategy. To move on, Mr. Speaker, to some of the contributions, and I want to come back to Mr. Lyons in regard. There was some, I know there were some slight comments made about the potential of my stance in Europe. But when we reflect on what actually Mr. Dunn said at the Economy Committee the other week, when he was concerned about what was going to happen in Northern Ireland when we left the European Union, maybe the DUP needs to look among its own members rather than looking this way first. So, you know, that may not be as clear as I'll gladly give way.
I can assure the member that as far as the Democratic Unionist Party is concerned, we're united on this issue.
Yeah.
Would perhaps the member like to outline his position on membership of the European Union?
If he asked Mr. Dunn on his position, because we have it in the register. Look, there's that look.
ask the member to address his remarks through the chair.
My apologies, Chair. I was trying to address and allay fears. I suppose one of the things that's different possibly about this party compared to the rest of them is when our executive passed its motion, which was actually taken by the executive of our department and wasn't made by a hierarchy that didn't consult its members, that although on balance the Ulster Unionist Party feels we're better within the European Union, members are allowed their own free thought, and I have that. I've given way to the member once, but I want to progress because I'll give way once. Sorry.
For giving way, and of course he's trying to make as good a job as he can to explain to this House the Ulster Unionist position. He must have found it extremely difficult when he was canvassing in the Assembly elections to get that point across, when he made it so many times that he was for leave, right, while his party is to remain.
Member, where I canvassed for leave. Can I ask the member, is he any proof of that? Or when I was asked the question on the doorstep, that I told the truth at all times, sure, maybe unlike some of the other candidates that were canvassing in North Antrim. Sure. No, I've given way once, I'll move on. Mr. Speaker, going back to the motion, because I know that I think the Business Committee and the Commission has taken legal advice that Europe's not to be debated in this House, although some would like it to be, no more than myself. Moving on to some of the other contributions, in regard to Mr. Farry as the previous Employment and Learning Minister, when he seemed to cast aspersions this way that I used to be critical of strategies coming out of the Department of Employment and Learning. Maybe I point out that we weren't just critical of the strategies coming out. It was the 13 strategies that the Department held that had 233 recommendations, the 14 implementation plans that the Department held that had 197 recommendations. So a Department that had actually 430 recommendations that was done away with, maybe give some of the credence or some of the weight or some of the acknowledgement that other parties in this House seen on the work, the very good and valuable work that was coming forward. And when it comes forward to those strategies, maybe the economic and activity strategy, if fully implemented and fully funded, would have a supporting mechanism into our manufacturing strategy that we're putting forward today. Mr. Speaker, I think I've made the case why we see that a standalone manufacturing strategy should be brought forward as part of the programme for government. And what concerns me is the talk that this programme for government has gone out for consultation. The Chair of the Economy Committee has said the stakeholders will be listened to. But when the opposition has brought forward a motion asking that a manufacturing strategy be central to the programme for government, the main government party come forward with an amendment to show and to demonstrate that it wouldn't. It would be part of an economic strategy. So as far as I'm concerned, as far as we're concerned, the programme for government consultation has already finished. It has already been decided upon. And this place can be clear that a standalone manufacturing strategy will not be part of this programme for government, because this amendment that has been put forward by the DUP clearly demonstrates that.
Hear, hear, hear.
The question is that the amendment standing on the marshal list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No. Aye.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Order. Members will resume their seats. Order. Members will resume their seats. The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
All those, any aye contrary, if any, no.
No. Aye.
Do we have tellers? Order. Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are George Robinson and Alex Easton. Tellers for the noes, Robin Swan and Steve Aiken. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left.
secure the doors. Their seats. Clerk, read the result.
Simple majority division result. 95 members voted, 58 members voted aye, 37 members voted no. The amendment is therefore agreed.
The question is the amendment is agreed. The question is that the motion as amended be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no. The ayes have it. The ayes have it.